The following podcast is brought to you by the Jonas Podcasting Network, found exclusively at wrestlingwithjonas.com.
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, Billy, as always, and I am joined on this edition with the Mad Dog from WrestleZone, Bradley Evans. Welcome to the show.
Hello.
So thank you for being on. I'm trying to get more folk from WrestleZone on, just because I could probably speak to them forever, which maybe that's why a lot of them are avoiding me, because of it. But first question is always the same.
All right.
Go for it. How did you get into pro wrestling? What got you hooked?
I don't really remember my first introduction into pro wrestling. I've got a brother that's 4 years older than I am. He was a wrestling fan, so it was always on the TV. So I don't really remember my first match, really. But I do remember, like, the early 2000s, you know, the brand split then, you know, Raw, SmackDown. I was a SmackDown guy. My brother was a Raw guy. But then, just wanting to do, like, watching the TV and going, oh, this is cool. I want to do this. And just always sticking to myself and going, I'm going to do this. Having a weird phase at school where it's just like, don't really want to do it, maybe. I don't know. And then once I left school, had no idea that wrestling had school. And eventually when I heard, as you know, Nathan and myself, we went to it, we'd done it, and we're doing it just now.
Yeah.
Story.
I did think there was going to be a little bit of a crossover, because of course spoke to Nathan, which is right now, as of recording, it's the episode that's going out next week, I think. But it's still a couple of weeks away in our timeline, in this recording timeline. but yeah, so you said early 2000s SmackDown brand split. Who were your favourites? Who caught your eye?
Eddie Guerrero. He was my guy. I loved Eddie. Eddie Guerrero. All the Cruiserweight guys. I was a massive Cruiserweight fan. I love Cruiserweights. When I was a kid. You know, of course, when you see like the backflips and all the flippy sort of stuff, it's like, oh, I could totally do this. And then, no, I can't.
We all went through that phase. I got a pair of really nice white trainers once that had like a blue strip down it, and I thought I was Rey Mysterio for the longest time, because I thought, oh, this is what Rey wears. He wears it with these big pleather gear, and you can flip. Because I'm wearing these trainers, I'll be able to flip. No,
yeah.
that was never happening. Yeah, sad enough, I was far too old to be able to be thinking about that, but, you know, that's just what happens. So, Cruiserweights, Jamie Noble, Harry Kane, Billy Kidman.
Yeah.
Just,
oh. Yeah, love them, man.
So, did you have a bit of an athletic background before you decided to go training, or was it just a go for it?
No. No, I was not athletic. I could barely run. I wasn't a massive guy, but I was always quite pudgy, but I've always quite lazy at the same time when it came to doing like cardio stuff or whatever. But when I was 16, I joined the gym. So I went to the gym, but I was just lifting weights because like, lift weights, get big, right? But no, I was never athletic. I just thought, you know, give it a shot. Why not? Door is there. Open the door. Why not take it? Get the opportunity. And eventually, I went through all the paces. And it was very difficult because I got gassed very easily. I was just wanting to stop.
Were you aware of anything in Scotland? Did you go to any WrestleZone shows before you delved into the training, or how did you actually come across WrestleZone having a school?
So the first time I discovered WrestleZone was the Invenuity show back in like 2012. Nathan and I went to that show. I we went to a WrestleZone show, and it was kind of cool to see because it was in the town hall, and there was a lot of people in that town hall. Like, now we get told, well, now I'm getting told from whoever was wrestling on that show, there was like 200 plus people there. Well, okay, yeah, that's cool. Being a fan, you just didn't know. There's, you see people, you see bodies there. It's just really interesting, really cool. And then found out in school, and it was through Nathan's brother's friend at the time. He used to do training at WrestleZone, and he said, "Oh, if you go here, that, you'll get an email." And that's what we did. So we did it, and from, I want to say, maybe October time, maybe October, November time of 2015. That's when we started. And we both enjoyed it.
So what was your first thoughts then, as you first time, you said you got gas quickly, your cardio probably wasn't the best for training. So what was your initial thoughts of your first bumps, first drills? Was it something you still wanted to do? Obviously, it is, but still wanted to do at the time.
Oh yeah, definitely. Like, because when we got there, it was like, this is all I wanted to do. This, every wrestler says this, right? Everyone that does wrestling or whatever goes, this is what I want to do. This is what I really want to do. I really want to do this as a career. So, what kept me through it was the love of wrestling. Is, you know, when watching from when I was a kid, to watching then, to watching now, it's something I love, and it's like, well, I'm going to keep it going with the love I have for wrestling. And getting the drills and getting blown up quickly, it was like, God, you know, you know when you get really gassed and you're just standing there for a while, it was like, oh, Jesus. But I kept going. I kept doing it. And it's something. It's something. The first bumps, I remember we did it on mats. We did it on like crash mats the first time we did bumps. And I thought, okay, this is cool. And then when we had our ring day, we got in the ring. Jeez, it felt good. people in my group, in our group, were going, oh, it's back, or whatever. Take the bump. Oh, that wasn't too bad. That was pretty fun. Hit the ropes. Oh, that's pretty fun. Yeah. Get a little bit mark in the back, whatever. But hitting the ring with doing a bump, hitting the ropes. It didn't make me, man. I'm very tolerant to pain, so that's probably why.
I was gonna say, I think you're the first person so far that I've asked about bumps, and you've went, it's all right. One of those things. Everyone else seems to go, awful, hated it, hurt. You're like, yeah, hi. It was just one of those things. So about just less than 2 years later, then you're making your debut in Montrose. I've got here, according to the Germans, a cage match, which obviously tell the truth 100% of the time, in a six-man tag match. So what was it like in the run-up to that match when you're told that you were going to be in the ring? And of course, you were opposite Nathan North as well in that match. So what was your thoughts going into it?
Scared. Terrified. Scared, terrified, but at the same time, it was like looking forward to it. Very excited because it was our first match. Of course, because we did the Battle Royal in like late 2016. So coming from the Battle Royal to the match, the six-man tag in Montrose, we were very scared. Well, I was scared anyway. I was terrified. I'm not a big person that likes to go out for crowds, but very terrified, excited. As soon as we got told, I remember getting told, you guys are going to be debuting at Montrose, yeah, yeah, yeah. And it's like, okay, cool. Getting the excitement built up, and then it's just like, oh, you know, rubbing the hands, can't wait, get backstage. We're excited to go out there. We get out there, it's just, everything went away, man. It was felt nice. I felt very relaxed.
Again, that's another very common thing comes across. It's like, I mean, for yourself, you said yourself, you're not a, like big crowd person. So did you find once you actually went through the curtain, everything went away? I mean, you're coming in as the face as well, which is a very difficult task because you're brand new. WrestleZone fans are very welcoming, which is fine. But did you find that a bit daunting that you had to try and get them on side straight away?
It was very difficult. I had no idea how I was going to do it. I was, you know, was seeing a babyface brand, very, very bland babyface, like, yeah, I'm here. So it was very difficult for me to try and win over the fans because back in my mind, it's like, do these people like me? Do these people want to cheer me? Am I, you know, you're doing the come on, let's go, the Jeanette babyface sort of stuff. And it's just like, are they just doing that because I'm just telling them to do that? So it was very much a terrifying experience for the babyface role that I had in trying to step my, you know, to step the ball. And it was just so difficult. And I hate it. I truly hate it.
I always found from my experience anyway, going to shows, if I see like yourself and Nathan North, a couple other guys, when I see them the first once or twice, there's nothing there. It's just trying to get the basics down. And then because I only get up for like the bigger shows during the year, unless you come to Keith or something. And then it's usually like 4-5 months later, I'll come in and go, who is this guy? Because it's not the guy I saw previously. It's like, I don't know what it is about WrestleZone, but it seems to be once you're thrown into the deep end, once you get in front of the crowd a couple of times, you know what they react to, everything falls into place from that point onwards. I mean, what are your I was going through cage match, and not even within a year, you're in the ring with Andy Wilde in Brechin. How was that experience?
That was cool. Andy is one of those guys I've always wanted to wrestle, for sure. Being in the ring with Andy was so very experience. It was experience in itself. With just one of these names in British wrestling that you can just go, you know, that guy is, he's definitely got something there. Learned quite a few things from Andy for sure. His chops are fun. People within WrestleZone were ribbing me with Andy and telling me, oh, you better watch for his chops. You better watch for his chops. He's going to hit you. You know, just winding me up. I'm like, oh, all right, you know. I remember when Andy first chopped me, he chopped me. And I started walking, because I think we were outside the ring, and he felt me with a chop. And I almost started smiling. And I was like, wait a minute, I can't do that. And I'm like, But it was just, it felt like a badge of honor getting chopped by Andy Wilde, for sure. He's a great guy. I love Andy. I love him.
Yeah, I've heard, I've never experienced it, thankfully, but I have heard many a chop rattle around places like the Northern Hotel and even the ballroom. Which sound shouldn't really rattle that much in the ballroom, but it does, especially those. Again, I mean, when I was going through, I mean, I must have seen you fairly near start then, because I would have seen you in your first Aberdeen Anarchy, which was the pre-show, tag team match with Blue Thunder. So it's the ballroom. It's a big place. Of course, the pre-show, so we've been like the first three rows, I think, in that time. What was it like getting to wrestle in the beach ballroom itself?
That was the only thing that I wish was go for that. Because just okay, like seeing it in the pre-show was cool because you had like people there, of course. But when you seen the sellout, you know, everyone there, holy cow, it was just fantastic. Just even being behind the curtain or even going up to the balcony that we were at, just looking and just hearing the crowd. It was cool because, you know, you had a mixture of, like, you know, the regular fans and the non-really, maybe some of the non-regular fans were there as well. even just wrestling in the ballroom was just such a cool, cool experience, just because of the history of the ballroom. And it's such a fantastic venue that should be used more for wrestling, because who doesn't love the ballroom,
Absolutely. There's
I think everyone should have the experience of wrestling in the ballroom, for sure.
And it's one of those places that there's not a bad seat. I mean, if you go anywhere in that building, there's not a bad seat. I mean, I prefer the balcony because you get the bit, because for me, it's not a bad seat, but the balcony.
Oh, yeah.
You just see everything and you get best view, and it's amazing. And then, of course, you had a Battle Royal the year after, again, in the ballroom. And I don't know if it was more, I don't know if you found it not a letdown, but you made your main show debut in the ball at Aberdeen Anarchy, but it was in the Leisure Centre instead. Mm-hmm. Was there a bit of you that was a little bit gutted that it wasn't the ballroom?
Very good. I was very, very, very good. I remember we all got told that the Anarchy was going to be at the Leisure Centre. Yeah, just a big sigh just came out of me, just like, twice in a row that being all. And then this year, the year that Anarchy was coming, the Leisure Centre, it was like, before that, we didn't get told. We said, okay, we got to make my ballroom debut. This is going to be awesome. I can't wait for it. To then get told, it's going to be held at the Leisure Centre. It was very disappointing. But at the same time, it's Anarchy. I look forward to Anarchy shows because it's just a lot of fun. It's great fun. And it's...
Yeah, I mean, I know for me, the Leisure Centre, I think it was out with, from what I heard anyway, it was out with control, that it had to be elsewhere from the ballroom. But at least, at the very least, we are going to jump back and forth because I do have loads of stuff to speak about in the interim between that. But at least you were on a match with, involved with the guest that year, Pac. Of course, because it was Zach Dynamite against Pac. What was it like? Just a lot of these questions are, what was it like? But did you get any feedback from Pac for that match, or was it just what was it like being involved with him?
It was cool because this is like the first time I ever got involved with a big star, a big name. Pac was fantastic. He was just such I'm going to probably ruin him, but he's such a nice person. He was really nice. And I remember after the match, I thanked him for including Ryan and myself, because he could have said, no, I don't want them there. Just have a straight one-on-one match. But he was like, no, it's fine. You know, he was very, very cool. Being out there with all the fans going crazy for Pac, seeing everyone going absolutely ballistic for Pac was just awesome. Just standing in the middle of the ring when he's making his entrance, just seeing him coming down, you know, you're there, you want to fight him, you know, you're there, you're in character. And then it's just like, but hearing the fans, it's just goosebumps, absolute goosebumps. Just hearing the fans and just seeing him walking out, it's just insane.
Yeah, I mean, the thing with Pac, I found it so funny that because he was hanging around before the show started, he was watching the pre-show, but with just out with the fans, and I was just watching it thinking, oh man, if I'm in this pre-show match, I am absolutely bricking it. That I'm not only, because of course all the imports will be watching it backstage or what have you, but to have him like there watching it, you can see him watching it. It's just sounds like a terrifying experience.
I don't think they knew, to be honest.
Oh, well, look at that.
I don't think they knew about it.
But I was just watching it, and then I was with Mark Leslie, who was watching it with, and he just looked at me and went, Pac's there. I was like, oh, okay. All right. Have fun, guys. So that was your first match. It was a triple threat tag team match, I think, rejected in the outfit. Yep. So again, this is your first actual main show. It's not the ballroom, but it's one of the largest crowds that wrestlers don't get during the year. we'll go right back to the start of that kind of story, which really started, I would say, start of 2017, teaming with Zach, first of all. So it was Zach, someone I know, he does a little bit of training with the school as well. Was he one of your trainers, and that how it was put together, or how did that tag team relationship start up?
So that was definitely a helping hand into my training for sure. I think it's just the reason I think it just came together was just because Zach and I, you know, we speak a lot. We spoke a lot back then, and we still speak a lot now, and we do have a friendship there. So I think it's just because, you know, we're just friends, and there was nothing I was doing, and then there was nothing that he was doing. So we did put us together, see what would happen, and put us together, and I enjoyed it. I really did. I enjoyed working with Zach. Tag team wise, he's great guy. He's really good as well at what he does too. He's very underrated, I think, for sure.
It's one of those, like, I know everyone's going to listen to this and go, oh, it's just going to go on to a big lovey-dovey fest about WrestleZone, but it is, because it's the company I go to. But it's one of those really long burning stories, because of course you're teaming, and then the January 2017, I think, the summer whole showdown.
2018,
thank you. 2018. You were his second against Aspen Faith, and then he lost, and then he attacked you, so that brought in a little bit of a feud between the 2 years. And then Arden Anarchy that year, you were coming out, so you were in the ballroom, but you're coming out as Mr. P's second with the big flag and all that jazz.
Yeah.
And then you... unceremoniously, Death Valley drivered Mr. P and gave Zach the win. So it's a whole like 9 month story, slow burning, the wrestlers are so good at doing. But was there a bit of you, it's like, oh, great, I'm back teaming with Zach again for that?
Oh, yeah, definitely, for sure. like, I hated my babyface run. I really did hate it just because I didn't put 100% into it, and I wasn't believing in it. So doing the Terran Anarchy with Zach was just, I loved it. I was looking forward to it. Just doing the whole, I think Zach and I are a good team. So why not go back with my old friend and help him win back the belt? Why not?
Of course that turned you heel, and you were with Zach for a bit. Not for a bit, you still are. So is that your kind of thought? You much prefer being the bad guy, and I mean the bad guy's not like it's an easy job, but it's a lot more fun, so I've heard.
Oh yeah, it's a lot more fun for sure. You get away with a lot more things than you do in big face.
I was going through just your Facebook and just other your fan page Facebook, not your actual Facebook. I'm not a stalker. And there was a video that really caught my eye when I was watching it, and it was Granite City Comic Con 2019, where you had a run in with a certain Darth Vader. What was it like getting force choked?
Well, I nearly died. meeting Darth Vader was an experience in itself there. It was very, very daunting. You know, I thought I could take him on, but obviously I couldn't take him on. It was horrible. It was horrible, man. Like, I'm still recovering from that. I can still feel a few bones in my throat getting better, you know?
It's horrible. It's the weirdest thing about it. I met Darth Vader at Disneyland, and I mean, I'm not gonna spoil it for anyone, but it's not actually Darth Vader. But there's so intimidating about a guy dressed up as Darth Vader. I don't know what it was. I was just like going, "Oh, you're actually Darth Vader." I'm a little bit scared, even though I'm in Disneyland. I don't think he's actually gonna do anything. But yeah, it was just a very weird time. So again, we're just jumping everywhere. You. Regal Rumble 2019, the foundation of the future was finally fully formed with Ryan Riley running out and with his protein shake, and the team was born. Again, was that just good friends with Ryan that it just went all together, or was it just a case of you guys are young, throw you all together?
We're young and we want to take WrestleZone over. We thought, why don't we bring Ryan into the mix? We needed a third guy. So why not Ryan? You know, he's this trainee. Well, he was a trainee that was progressing really well, and he was showing very, very good improvements in so much things. Why not bring in Ryan? You know, he can go, man. Ryan can go. He's good at what he does as well. I love Ryan.
And then you went right into a big rivalry with the Rejected as well. So this is like the three. Three of you guys, foundation and future, of course, are no slouches. But you're coming in against these brawlers and Chris Archer and doing a bit of high flying and all that kind of stuff. So it was kind of a good mix of styles. What are your thoughts? What were your thoughts on that kind of your matches you had with the Rejected?
I like them. Yeah, they were. They were different, I think, from other matches that I've been a part of. Just because there's different characters, there's different styles in the match itself. When you had the straight tag match in the Rudy from 2019, we kept the daylights out of each other. We really did. And then when we had that first match, a first six-man tag match at Halloween. That was an experience as well, because just listening to the crowd when we were facing the entranceway, we had no idea that we were behind us, and hearing the crowd just go, that was, and looking around, and there they are, boom, 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 they're on us, and then we're back on them. And then, you know, Vago comes over and gives me the big Foley clothesline over the top rope, and that was awesome. Just awesome. I loved it.
And of course, we'll kind of round off how your wrestling career's gone, then we'll pick out bits from there. Your last match, of course, you before the world ended, you're due to enter the Regal Rumble last because you won a triple threat. So, I mean, at this point, that's a pretty good spot to be in for a Rumble.
We're
talking... Well, that's 2020. So you went from pre-show Aberdeen Anarchy in 2017 to last spot in the Regal Rumble. That's a pretty good 3 years for
pretty good.
Not too bad. So in that time, what has been some of your favourite matches or moments, even if it's something odd like an Alan Sterling moment, which seems to be frequent?
Well, I do Alan Sterling. It's just awesome. I love wrestling Aspen Bay, the matches that we had, because I learned a lot from Aspen. Again, I wasn't happy with them, but I loved them because it was all my, you know, better degree at the time, and babyface Bradley Evans horrible. This is what Aspen I loved. The match with Andy I loved. That's probably the ones that stick out for me that I really like. The whole foundation of the future thing that's going on just now, I was very looking forward to it as soon as we got told that we're going to be doing this team. I don't know. I love it. That's all I can say. Well, I'm looking forward to whenever we can get back to So when our whole planet wakes up again, Aberdeen Anarchy, whenever that happens, I hope that's going to be a good one for those two nights. For the Regal Rumble, when I can finally make my number 5 win it, I don't know. I'm looking forward to that too. So
I know I was so glad when everything
future moments that's going to happen. I hope.
Yeah, I was so glad with everything. Sorry, I don't know if it's my signal or connection, but there seems to be just like I said, a bit of a delay. But yeah, I was so excited for Anarchy this year for two nights because I had so much planned. I'd booked the Northern Hotel that night, the first night, thinking I'll maybe be able to grab a couple of years. We'll do some interviews and that. And that's why I've started the podcast instead. But I thought, great, this is going to be an amazing networking opportunity. And it all died. It all cancelled. But Northern Hotel is it's a wild venue. It doesn't pack as many in as a leisure centre or a ballroom. But the Northern Hotel is one of those atmospheric venues for WrestleZone, I would say.
Definitely. Oh yeah.
Weird things happen.
Definitely. Yeah.
I've seen Sanjay Dutt.
Weird things happen all the time.
Yeah, I've seen Sanjay Dutt chase Jack Jester with a walking stick. I've seen Alan Sterling eat soap. It's just one of those venues. I've seen Jack Jester push over a guy as well. It's just amazing. Right, you've made some design choices in your gear over the years, and one of them is your masks, a mask specifically, by Camp Blood Masks. What was the inspiration behind that? I know there seems to be a lot of, I've no idea. I'm not very much into the horror stuff, so I'd look stupid if I'd guessed who it's for. But what was the inspiration behind the mask?
Okay, so the guy who does it, his name's... I first seen his stuff at the Comic-Con where I got first shot by Darth Vader. And I was just at a stall, and I'm looking at all this stuff and going, this is cool stuff, you know, I could probably do something with this. And I was telling Scotty about it. I said, well, I seen this guy at the Comic-Con with all these masks. I think they're cool. I might ask if I can get one made for myself. He goes, oh, I know him. I'll mess him for you and add him a face, whatever. So I just said to him, so my original idea for the mask was to have like a zombie dog sort of look to it, because the Mad Dog, right? So I was like, well, maybe if I get that, because it suits the character, suits who I am, it'll look like a dog, it'd be cool. So I spoke to him, gave him my idea, and he goes, well, I can't really work with that, but how about we do this instead? So we get the Jason Voorhees type style, then we get the Hannibal Lecter, Hannibal Lecter mask thing over it, and put some blood on there, make it look like a zombied out. He showed me the picture. I was like, this is really cool. This is going to be cool. And I said to him, look, I'm going to use you as my mask guy for making my entrance mask. And I was meant to be getting a few made for Anarchy as well. So I'm very disappointed that that didn't work out. But if anyone wants to get one, you know, go to Camp Blood Masks and hit Lemmy up. I'm sure he'll sort one out for you. He does everything. It's cool.
Did he do? I know again for Leisure Centre Aberdeen Anarchy, the Crusher came out with a mask as well. Was it kind of the same guy, or do you know?
No, I don't know where Crusher got his one done, but no, it's totally different.
It was so weird. I was watching him like I don't know what it was in reference to, because I kept thinking he looked like a Sentinel from X-Men. But when I saw the mask properly, I was like, no, that's not it. That's not it at all. It's like a goblin thing instead. The boots. Yeah, you debuted the furry boots at, I can't remember when, but was that inspiration from Bruiser Brody, or what was the story behind them?
So I debuted the boots and the chain at Aberdeen Anarchy 2019. It was basically, you know, for Bruiser Brody, you know, I was doing a lot of research for Bruiser Brody, and I love Bruiser Brody. He's definitely for sure one of my favorites. And I thought, well, why not do that? I don't see anyone else doing it on the scene. Why not I do that? And I brought the chain. I was like, I need a chain. I don't know why. I just thought, well, I need a chain. So I got these horrible boot Roman's buzzing. So that broke straight away. And I had to buy another pair, and that broke straight away. So then when I got my my tag team wrestling gear last year, I actually got some made. And so they're going to last longer than the old ones, because the old ones were, they were good, but they weren't very good at the same time. They break very, very, very easily. So, yeah, that's the story behind that. Nothing spectacular. It's just a little nod to Bruce Brody.
Well, speaking of Bruce Brody, we had Scotty Swift send in a question. Well, not so much a question, but a challenge. He's put Terry Funk, Stan Hansen, Bruce Brody. You can only pick one.
See, I woke up this morning to that question, and I have no idea. I love Terry Funk. Those three are probably my favorites. Terry Funk, Bruiser Brody, and Stan Hansen are my favorites. So I'm gonna pick Brody. I'm gonna pick Bruiser. Why not?
Love Bruiser. Well, if it was a dead heat, I came up with a new game for an episode that's coming out soon anyway, called Wrestle Tag Bury, where you take these three. It's like Shark, Marry, Kill, but not as creepy. And it's pretty much wrestle one, tag with one, bury one. So you just, I suppose, kill. It was kill initially, and then it just didn't sound right. So we'll do it with them. I'm assuming wrestling is going to be Brody, although I've seen Brody wrestle, maybe not. What would be your wrestle tag? I mean, just because he's mental, that's why, not because he's a bad wrestler. So yeah, wrestle tag, Barry, Terry Funk, Stan Hansen, Bruiser Brody.
Okay, so wrestle Brody. Oh God, this is so difficult. I would tag with Terry, and I'd have to put it Stan.
I think Glendon Barr is going to be very upset with you with his answer for
the I think he is. I'm sorry.
And we also got our question in from Mickey Vado, Vago, not Vado. I'm thinking of Darth Vader. It's got in my mind now. Mickey Vado here. He's put, because he's obviously spoke to you already for his podcast, which will be coming out, would have been like 2 weeks before this one does. He said, who'd win a match between the Good Brothers and Sex Ferguson and Chad Too Bad?
Oh, God. Oh, jeez. I'm going to have to go with Sex Ferguson and Chad Too Bad, because they're total brothered up right there, so... Why not them?
but I mean, I don't want to spoil anything, but Sex Ferguson doesn't have any eyes. So I'm a little bit...
That is true. You can bring his minions, I don't know.
Pelvis Wesley, you can
come in. Yeah. Pelvis Wesley, yeah, you can bring his minions. Yeah, you can bring out him. Because the substitute.
So way back to the start then, you said you came in with Nathan North, of course Marcus North, with the name he hates, I don't know why I said it. What was it like getting your first singles match with Nathan?
Oh, it was cool, but at the same time we didn't want to do it because we were so green. We'd rather work with an experienced guy, but when we had when was our first match? So our first match was, I want to say, was it in Brody? I think it was in Brody, right? I don't know.
I think it was Fan Appreciation Night, maybe.
Yeah, I think so. But I remember being nervous but happy because I'm wrestling my best friend. You know, I've known him for 10 plus years. So I was like, okay, this is going to be weird. So got told we were 2-3 at the same time. We're still on the show. That's the main thing. We're still on the card. That's the main thing. Each other. It's gonna be cool. I remember there was a photographer. I think it was for the one of the local papers here called the Advertiser, the Herald. I can't remember which one it was. And I never got to see it. So.
So if anyone's out there has a copy of it, send it to you. To see whatever article it was.
Yeah.
A couple of our regular questions, our stupid questions that we ask. What's your favourite dinosaur?
Favourite dinosaur? I've been looking forward to this question. My favourite dinosaur. Right. So this dinosaur is the coolest dinosaur that's ever lived. This dinosaur can do everything and anything. Billy, my favourite dinosaur is Luchasaurus.
Ah, good one.
That's my favourite dinosaur.
I was really scared it was going to be something like Johnny Saint. But it was, yeah, Luchasaurus.
I would never do that.
Of course, we all love Johnny Saint here, just in case he watched me and wants to stretch me at all. Another new question, which I don't think is on an episode that's went out yet, it's because it's coming out this week. Who would win in a fight? Two sheep or one cow?
Two sheep, you know, because they're just, you know, tag teaming.
Sheep's picking up now. Cow was drawn ahead for a lot of these, but sheep. I'm on the two sheep bandwagon. But there's some people that somehow do believe a cow would beat them. I'm not convinced. But I don't know how. I think I need a third stupid question to put in here. But I've got two so far that I'm running with. I'm sure Jason Hyde will come up with some odd eventually because he seems to. Right, back to the wrestling then. Again, boring questions that everyone gets asked when you do interviews. What were some of your favourite matches growing up? Or now, actually.
Okay. I don't have a lot of favourite matches. I'll tell you some of the favourite people I love watching. I love watching Macho Man Randy Savage. Just love him. So I love watching Macho Man. I love watching Bruiser Brody. Terry Funk. I love watching Terry Funk. Stan Hansen. I love Stan Hansen. But I'll tell you a story with one that I forget. And that was WrestleMania 20, Kane and Undertaker, when Undertaker came back, right? So my brother and I watched that match. Well, watched the whole show. We recorded it. And then we reached it at our grandparents' place. And after watching the show, I used to do wrestling in my back garden. And so my brother and I did the Undertaker game match. He was under. We did everything spot for spot, bit for bit. And it came up to the tombstone. And he picked me up for it. And I said, don't drop me. Just no, I won't drop you. You'll be fine. Boom! He just dropped me on my head. So I remember did like a big like headstand, and I landed on my feet. I ran inside and I sat down, and I'm taking a couple breaths and hold my head. Okay, let's go finish the match. So I went out and finished the match.
Like a true wrestler. It's fine.
My heart. It's in my blood.
I'll walk it off. It's all good. I really like this because it's just like it seems to be wrestling. It's just yeah, fine. Just go for it. Is that how the Mad Dog kind of thing came about? Because you're always ready for a fight. Nothing really phases you. It seems to be. You're always just ready to go.
I probably do. So yeah, like I'm very much pretty much immune to pain. It's weird because I could like stub my thumb and I'm like, oh, okay. I remember my hand opened with a saw. I just looked at it and started laughing. And I said, I'll be fine. I'll just put plaster on it, I'll be fine. But it's like, no, you need to go get stitches. So I'm like, okay. But the idea for the Mad Dog character, it's, I'd say it's definitely 100% me. But it's drunk me. Said. Okay. So I think Mad Dog character as me being drunk, where I'm like loud and bah and crazy. So you got a little bit of me in there. You got a little bit of Bruce Brody in there, of course. You got a little bit of Brian Pillman when he did the loose cannon stuff. Maybe a bit of Terry Funk, Hanson again. Alex Jones, you know. You got a little bit of him in there too, because why not? I love Alex Jones. See, when you watch Alex Jones and stuff, man, what a great character, right?
I know. You don't want to believe he's a real person. Something comes out. So I mean, you're going on about it, like Hansen, of course. I mean, you started watching Cruiserweights, and you went back to watching guys like, well, I suppose people say menly men doing manly things, yeah. Eating meat.
Oh yeah.
What got you going from the Cruiserweights to going back to guys like Brody and Terry Funk? Did you watch ECW? Did you get tapes? How'd you get back there?
YouTube. I like old school wrestling. I'm not talking about like the 50s and all that. So I like. It's weird because I don't like 80s WWF. I don't mind it. It's not my cup of tea. But like watching 80s like old Japan pro wrestling with Stan Hansen against the Funk Brothers, I'm all over that. Take my money. Terry Funk, when I first seen Terry Funk was ECW One Night Stand 2005, and it was 2006. I think it was 2006. But I just remember going, this guy is awesome. I love Terry Funk. Who is Terry Funk? So YouTubing Terry Funk and watching Terry Funk, like when he did the empty arena match with, that was awesome. I watched that match recently, and I just forget how awesome he is in that match and the way he does stuff as well. But I really don't know how I got into watching it, because like you said, Cruiserweights, I always loved the Cruiserweights, and I still love the Cruiserweights. I love like watching small guys flip about and bounce about. I think it's cool. But I also loved, you know, watching this big, you know, 6 foot, maybe 6'3" guy, 6'4" or 6'5" guy, just punching a guy, you know. That's, I don't know. It's a very strange combination.
I know, it is literally chalk and cheese. I suppose when it was Crusher and Connor, that must have been just your, like, that's it. That's what I want. Massive guys, yeah. Flippy dudes. Brilliant.
All over it.
A guy that I don't know how... I think I was reading, what was the book called? I think it was a book about Brody's death, I think. I can't remember what it's called, but I bought it at the same time as bought Ring of Hell, which was about Benoit, so I can't remember the name of it. But it was one of those guys, him and Magnum TA, are two guys that I was always... I don't often venture back that far, but Bruiser Brody and Magnum TA are two guys, so it's like, oh, what could have been? What if?
Yeah.
Because they were so... interesting and good and character and just everything you'd want in a wrestler.
For sure.
So as far as dream matches go, I'm going to assume it's going to be one of them three that we've mentioned already, but let's go for people that are active. Oh, Terry Funk, I suppose.
Okay.
What would be your dream match, fancy match, anywhere?
I really don't know. That's the difficult question, because it's funny because I don't have a dream match. I would like to wrestle. Well, actually, you know what? Okay, I'll give you one. I'll give you one, actually. One just came to mind. It's a match that I've always wanted to have, and it's against Irvin Garrett. I remember he said to me after when he first see me wrestle, I think it was, with the Mad Dog character, he said, oh, I'm loving it. When are we having a match? I'm like, I don't know. I'll ask somebody and we can get a match started. But that's the only guy I want to wrestle right now, because I know he's game for it and I'm game for it. And that's all I want. That's all I want right now is to wrestle Irving Garrett. That's all I want.
I'm just, the thought in my head is like, how do you get out of a wrist lock? Punch him in the head. And that seems to be the dynamic that it would be. I'm all in for that. Yeah, I'll definitely watch that. Of course, like I said, assuming if Terry Funk decided, right, I'm going to have another retirement tour and I'm coming over to Scotland, you'll be like, me. I will be in there.
I would be sending everything to every promoter going, I want this match with Terry Funk. Give it to me. Please.
So, of course, the world ended last year. And of course, like we said, you're due to be in the Regal Rumble. But how have you been keeping yourself occupied in the last 12? Well, now it is 12 months.
Okay, so when first lockdown happened, before lockdown happened, I was losing weight and got back to the gym and trying to look good for Anarchy. And I was like, that was my goal, was to look good for Anarchy. And then when lockdown happened, I was like, you know what, I'm just going to pig out. So I pigged out and I put a lot of weight on. So I remember December, I was like, okay, so that's in January, I'm going to try to lose the weight, get more active and try and just lose it. But I did go to the gym when the gyms opened up again in September. I was like, well, every day, I was at the gym every day. Almost every day. And gym's closed. I was like, well, we can't go to the gym. So I started doing DDP yoga again. I used to do DDP yoga back in 2014. And so I've been doing DDP yoga since January. And I'm still doing it now. I had a workout this morning. I'm trying to get my spine straightened because I was told by a masseuse that my spine is not aligned. So I need to get that sorted out. So I'm trying to fix it. I'm trying to fix my body and try and get in shape as well at the same time, which hopefully will work out in the end, which I'm hoping for.
DDP yoga is something I did it for about a week and then I stopped because I didn't care anymore. I was quite happy just eating, but it was one of those weird things where I had a really bad arm break, so I was kind of put off by anything like push-ups, press-ups, because I just don't have the physical strength in this arm to do it. But I did DDP yoga and I was like, oh my god, I'm actually working my whole body out without actually impacting anything. It was, yeah. I really need to get back into it because I did enjoy it. It was just, I could be bothered. So definitely something I need to get back to because it was a whole body workout in an hour. And after about an hour, I was sitting on the bed, side of the bed, just going, I don't know what happened, but I think I'm going to die. It was just one of those super weird moments. So outside of wrestling, though, I can see you've got, much like most people in wrestling, you've got some Ghostbusters gear on behind you. Although, if anyone's watched and seen Scotty Swift's interviews, that's nothing. So what are your passions outside of wrestling?
I like watching like TV shows and movies and playing video games. I'm not really like a big guy that likes to go out and, if I could, I would, but likes to go out for like big walks and big hikes and all this sort of stuff and complete marathons. I'm very much like, I just like being inside or going out with the dog, take the dog out for a walk and come back and just chilling and watch movies or watch a series or whatever. And that's probably the things I really like doing, is just relaxing and enjoying. And then going to the gym, like the gym is the biggest part that I love doing as well as going to the gym. Maybe I'll wake up, go to the gym for 10 o'clock, come back, eat lunch, take the dog out, sit, relax. You know, if it's an off day when I'm not working, then yeah, for sure. I love going to the gym and looking after my dog. It's probably the main things I love doing.
I think we would. That's the thing with this whole pandemic thing. I am quite happy being alone. I like my own company. More happy. I'll do exactly the same as yourself. I'll take the dog out, maybe. I'll watch TV, relax. But because of this pandemic, I don't get the choice to do that. As in, I have to do that. Yeah. I'm assuming it's the same as yourself. It's like, it's a bit, getting a bit stir crazy because you're sitting there going, I have to stay inside, but I want to have the choice to stay inside. that's the weird thing, isn't it? But yeah, I'm in the same kind of boat. This is my social interaction now. forever, it seems to be, until things get back to normal. Right, so I'm getting the feeling, just because you're super chilled, goals and aspirations, you're really just taking them as they come. If you can get a match with Irvin Garrett, you'll be quite happy. You'll tick that off as you go. But is there any dreams to do Japan, go to Japan, or go to, I don't know, AEW, WWE, anything like that? What's the end game?
Well, so for just now, with like, because when I first started wrestling, the first goal I wanted to do was get to WWE. That's a huge picture, right? So now I'm looking at it as like small goals. So my goals for just comes back to normal is to debut for another promotion, because I've never got that. I never had the chance to debut for another promotion. I would love to go down to Discovery and wrestle for Discovery, because I think Discovery's fantastic. They've got a great roster of guys, great guys and girls. They got just an awesome setup. And it's just an awesome environment to be around as well. But I would love to go to Japan and wrestle Japan. I'd love to go to Germany. I would love to wrestle like in the States as well. Maybe for like a Ring of Honor, or maybe an Impact or something. You know, maybe an AEW or WWE. But for just now, the small goals is definitely wrestle for another promotion within the UK. I would love to do that.
Definitely a guy that comes to mind when you said Impact was Joe Doran. He seems to be right up your street from our chat so far.
Yeah, well, I haven't really watched any of his stuff, but definitely, yeah.
Just from the look of him, a big scary dude in a cowboy hat and cowboy boots and black trunks. Seems like you shouldn't look intimidating.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'd hopefully we could do a chat again and there'll be some actual wrestling to speak about. I'm hoping that time next time will be the first night of Aberdeen Anarchy, and I've dragged a couple of years, not in a weird way, by going, come back to my hotel room and let's have a chat. But hopefully that's next time we can speak. But in the meantime, where can people find you on social media?
Okay, so you can find me on Facebook, Bradley Evans. You can find me on Twitter at Bradley Evans PW, and Instagram, Bradley, I think it's Bradley _Evans_TKO, or it might just be Bradley Evans _TKO, one of those two. That's where you can find me, interact with me, tweet me, DM me, whatever.
Can people still get a Foundation of the Future t-shirt?
Yeah. Definitely. Message either myself or Ryan Riley, and I'm sure that we can organize something for you.
Excellent.
They're still all left. They look cool. Look at them.
Great. That's going to be the screen grab I use just for plugging the episode, just the Foundation of the Future.
Look how great that looks. Buy one. Give us money.
good for all body sizes, from someone who's in shape like yourself and me, that's shaped like a potato. But yeah, thank you for watching. Oh, before I go, thank you for being one that sent in a happy birthday message for me for my 30th.
Oh, no worries. I hope you enjoyed it.
It was a bit, I knew nothing about it. It was literally, I saw it on the day. So my wife and Adam, who edited it together, they did a very good job of just not letting me know. So she recorded my reaction, and as soon as I finished, I was like, yeah, you're not putting that reaction anywhere. That video is going to stay with you. Thank you. But yeah, sorry, that popped into my head right at the end. But that's it. Thank you very much for talking to me today. And I'm very much looking forward to listening to your chat with Mickey Vago, which will definitely be a bit more sweary, I can tell. I know. Even though this one's coming out like a month later, everyone go back and listen to that with Vago. But yeah, thanks again.
No problem at all, though. Thank you.